Good afternoon. It's indeed my honor to be here and to speak to you just for a little while about leadership. And I try to make two promises anytime I have an opportunity to speak publicly. Wow, that's really loud. Number one, because I don't like to stand behind a podium. And where'd Evan go? Can you back me off just a little bit? Because I can speak a little bit louder and I'm going to keep feeling like I'm holding back. So when we think about leadership, you know, volumes have been written about leadership. There are great books written about leadership. But I want to share with you today some of what I've learned experientially. As Dr. Schiller mentioned, I was in the Marine Corps. I was a business owner for many years. I was a pastor for 14 years. An educator for 12 years, and now in the office that I hold as principal chief. Most of what I will share with you was learned experientially by doing it wrong the first time. Simple fact, you know, we can read books and that's good, and we can have people tell us, but really it's the hardest lessons are the ones that we never forget, right? So most of what I'm going to share with you comes experientially from doing it wrong the first time. And my hope is that you'll learn from my mistakes and not make the same mistakes that I've made when it comes to leadership. As mentioned, I spent 4 years as a Marine, 28 years as a husband, which is a great lesson in leadership right there. And that rule is pretty basic, which is mama's always right, even when she's wrong, which don't tell mom I said that. My beautiful daughter Brianna's here with me today, and I'm just honored that you're here today. It means a lot to me. 4 years as a business owner and 27 years as a father, which also is a great task and chore and lesson in leadership as well. We were joking earlier about, I said, Brianna, she was my first and probably one of the easiest. And then I've got my youngest who's about to be 17 who, wow, what a challenge. But each one of them has taught me different things about leadership and different things about myself. And we'll get more into that and how that plays out. As I said, I've had many opportunities for growth as a leader. Most of what I know comes from the personal experience of doing it wrong the first time. So I want to share with you today, very briefly, seven truths about effective leadership. Now, again, I didn't read this in a book. I will quote other people, but this is just from my life experience here. Effective truth number one about leadership, I'm last. Leadership is not about you. Now, we have oftentimes, and I probably learned this more in the Marine Corps and certainly pastoring a church more than any place else, is people who think that they need to be in charge are not ready for leadership. If you think that, well, I need to be in charge, that is a sure sign you're not ready for leadership. Because leadership is a servant position. It is not a position of driving people. It's called leadership, so we're leading people by example. This lesson was first learned, and it's a difficult lesson, when I was in Marine Corps boot camp. And anybody who's, if you're a veteran, you know, you learn this one. I used to say it when I was pastoring a church, everything I needed to know about Christianity I learned in boot camp. Because it really is, what they teach you is sacrificial servant leadership. The only thing missing is the love. There's a lot of yelling and screaming and things going on like that. But the servant leadership piece is there. And basically it is, you sacrifice yourself for the good of others. That's the lesson, right? And so the idea that being in leadership means you get to be in charge and boss people around is completely counterintuitive to what real leadership is. Real leadership is putting yourself in harm's way for the people who you are leading. It is you being out in front, setting the example, but also taking the fire. You know, I joke, I was vice chief for a while, and I joke with our new vice chief. I'm like, you got it easy, man. I'm like, all the bullets are coming at me. You know, you get to stand in the back and wave and smile. You know, when people are mad, and here's the thing, guys, it's just a simple truth about humanity. When things go wrong, immediately people are looking for someone to blame. And if you're in leadership, guess who's going to get the blame? You are, and you have to be ready for that. That's a difficult thing because I think if you're truly a leader and you truly care about people and your heart's in the right place, it's oftentimes very difficult to deal with the fact that people will say things about you, they will say hurtful things about you, they'll lie about you, they'll disparage your name and everything else, and yet you have to keep putting yourself out there and continue to lead. So effective truth number one is servant leadership. It's not about you. Leadership is not about you. It's about the people who you serve. Another point underneath that heading is this: leadership is lonely. You'll find very often in leadership that there will be few who will understand the pressure that you're under. There will be even lesser few who understand the stress that you're under. And there'll be even fewer people whom you can confide in. Leadership is lonely. I was just watching Churchill the other day. Wow. Powerful movie. If you get a chance, watch it. Great, great, great leadership truths in that movie. But oftentimes, when you're in leadership, you are going to be alone. You know, and there's not going to be very many people that you can confide in who will understand what you're going through. You know, in that same vein, if you find somebody that you can confide in and that you can trust in, hold them close, keep them near. But I will say this, there'll be few and far between. And most oftentimes, it'll be sleepless nights. And I joke with people all the time that, you know, they say, well, how you doing? I say, well, I go to sleep thinking about it. And as soon as I wake up, the hamster gets on the wheel again. And that's bad. that's the part that's difficult, because it's all the time. It's 24/7. When you have put yourself in a position where you are going to be responsible for what happens in the lives of other people, and every decision that you're making, you're considering the fact that how is this going to impact the people at the other end of this decision. It's a weighty thing. It's not an easy thing. And I guess probably the frustrating part is again, there won't be people around you necessarily who understand what you're going through. And when you say, well, I'm dealing with this, this, and this, well, it's no big deal. Yeah, easy for you to say. So it's a challenge. In the same vein and in this principle is the hard truth that finding people who you can truly trust and confide in will be few and far between. Even more painful is this: when you take the leap of faith and you trust somebody and then you find out they're not trustworthy. That's a painful lesson. How many people remember Braveheart? Who's old enough to remember the movie Braveheart? All the old people are like, yeah! All the college students are like, what's that? There were some young guys when I was pastoring a church. In fact, they were both going to Western at the time, and this has probably been about 8 or 10 years ago. And I asked them, I said, like, you guys, you know, like that movie in the scene in Braveheart? And they're like, what's that? I'm like, you don't have a man card yet, do you? So I said, come, young man, come sit and watch Braveheart. But do you remember the scene in Braveheart? Remember there's the, I can't remember the character's name. He was a Duke, he was got the goatee. He was really cool looking. And Mel Gibson's character had entrusted in him, and he was really, you know, trying to spur him on the leadership. He's like, they'll follow you, you know, and then they're having the fight, and they're fleeing from the battle. And he runs up against this one guy who's got a helmet on, and he's fighting with him, and the helmet comes off, and it's the man he's entrusted. And Mel Gibson, just, he's such a great actor, does this. There's this look of horror on his face and disappointment, and then his eyes well up with tears. And I remember watching that, and I still have my man card, but I did get choked up in that scene, because I'm like, wow, man, that's such a painful thing when you entrust, you place your trust in somebody, and you find out they're not trustworthy. Now, let me say this. Before you get really judgmental and start, like, yeah, I remember when that happened to me, we're all probably guilty as well. I mean, it gets real quiet on when you say that, right? But part of being a leader and being a good leader is that introspection and being honest with ourselves too, right? We're flawed too. We've all got flaws. All right, principle number two, and for you younger folks, when you get over 40 and when you get 50 like me, this is what you got to look forward to. Effective truth number two, compassion is an action. Great quote from John Maxwell: nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Compassion, I love the Greek word for that, literally means to suffer along with. I mentioned this at the last opportunity that I got to speak up here at Western. Compassion is one of those words that gets thrown a lot around in political rhetoric, but compassion is a verb. You know, compassion is not just some word floating out there in the ether that we get to throw around when we're running for office or we're trying to garner support. We say, you know, I'm going to be compassionate. Compassion literally comes alongside somebody when they're suffering, and they get in it with them. The issue with human beings is this, and if we're really honest with ourselves, we tend to flee from pain, right? We will do anything in most cases to get the path of least resistance with the least amount of pain. But real compassion will get in there and suffer along with when somebody is going through something. Is it easy? No. Is it painful? Yeah, it's painful. But see, that's compassionate leadership. Compassionate leadership comes alongside and says, I'm going to experience this with you. I'm not just going to pat you on the back and say, hey, listen, if you need anything, call me. I'm going to be here with you. This was one my wife used to have to help me with. I don't like funerals. I don't know very many people that do. I don't like them because I don't feel like I know what the right thing to say is. You know, we always feel like we have to have the right thing to say. And my wife said, you don't have to say anything. Just be there. Be there. She said, that's what people will remember. They'll remember that you were there and you held them. You were there and you put, you gave them a shoulder to cry on. Be compassionate. And know that compassion is not an action. It cannot be simply empty words. Charles Duhigg, in his book Smarter, Better, Faster, I'm sorry, I skipped a piece there. Number three, no one person knows everything. There's a great Cherokee principle on this one. You know, when we had chiefs, there were chiefs, plural. You had a war chief, you had a peace chief, you had beloved women, beloved men. There was always input from the community. Recognizing that there's no one person that has all of the answers wrapped up in one person. Now, here's what we've done in this country, right? We've made the president the king. And certainly not this one, but I mean, just in general. Don't start throwing stuff at me. What I mean by that is that the president was never supposed to be the all in all, right? It was a republic. It was a, you know, it was leadership of the people, by the people, and for the people. But what we do as human beings is we tend to look for somebody to follow. I had a conversation yesterday afternoon, and it started like this. This is how my day goes sometimes. Well, it's so great to see you. I just wanted to let you know how disappointed everybody is in you. Hey, it's great seeing you too. You know, part of this is that no matter what you do in leadership, someone's going to be mad at you. Someone will be mad at you. And certainly if you were in a political office, somebody will be unhappy with the decision you make. You cannot please everybody. And so, but with that, you know, when that happens, and it's almost, I would love to be able to say that I can set that aside, but I'm human, you know. And when somebody comes up and says that to you, I got to tell you, it weighs heavy on you, you know. I didn't sleep good last night thinking about that. I'm like, gosh, you know, I dealt with it later on this morning, because I was able to get on council and you know, before the camera, say, here's the actual story, here's what actually happened, here's what actually is going on. I don't know why I say all that. I guess because it's still on my mind and it still kind of bothers me. But no one person has all the answers. I told my leadership team, and some of them are here. The cabinet positions, the secretaries who are responsible for the divisions at the tribe. I said, listen. You know, please don't ever feel like you can't tell me something about me. I don't have all the answers. I don't. None of us do. I need good people around me who are subject matter experts in what they do. I need your life experience counseling me, right? There's a scripture in Proverbs that says, you know, in many counselors there's wisdom. And I think whenever we get to thinking that we have all the answers, we are surely headed for a fall. And so recognize that there's no one has all the answers. And I think we were having a conversation earlier today when we were having lunch Callie and I were talking about this. I said, you know, because we were talking about, I said, well, I'll try to stay away from political issues. She goes, no, get in the political. Well, I don't know if you really want me to do that. But you know, I said, here's the issue we're facing today, right? In this country, we are so polarized, we can't even have the conversation anymore. We just can't even have a civil conversation about it anymore. Everybody thinks they're right. And the reality is this, is that in any given situation, you're wrong about something. I'm wrong about something. Bring it closer to home in personal relationships, because really it's what it's all about, is relationships. In marriage, in family relationships, when there's a disagreement, when there's a fight, both sides are wrong. There's nobody that's like, you know, walking on water and doing everything right. So in these situations, recognize that the people you disagree with, they know something you don't. And you know something they don't. And at the end of the day, it's got to be mutual respect for one another as human beings. We have that in common. We are human beings. We're so polarized now. Social media, to me, it's like a curse. I know, you want to throw stuff now. But I mean, it's... What have we done with it? There's a great study. I don't know if anybody here listens to the Hoover Institute. They got a great podcast called Uncommon Knowledge. I love it. It's great. I can't remember the author's name, but he did a whole talk on how social media and the internet was supposed to bring us all together because we were all going to be able to communicate. And what has it done? Pretty much the opposite. I had an interesting opportunity talking to some members of our community. There are issues in our community that are certainly very polarizing. And I had one of them that disagreed with me, and I invited, and I said, come talk to me. Come talk to me, please. Let's talk. And she did. So we sat down and we talked. And the whole conversation came about was because I broke one of my first rules of leadership, which is never respond to a Facebook post. But I couldn't help myself because what was on there wasn't true. And I didn't get ugly. I just said, I would like to set the record straight. That's not true. Here are the facts. And now, see, being logical and reasonable, I thought what would happen is logical, reasonable discourse would follow. That never happens on Facebook. And it turned into this big, like 150 comments. And finally, I just said, well, somebody would please come talk to me. I'd be glad to talk to you. When this person came to talk to me, I said, before we even start this conversation, I want to apologize. And she said, for what? I said, I want to apologize for responding to a social media post. I said, and here's why. I said, in all the years I've seen these so-called debates on social media take place and all these so-called debates on Facebook take place, I've never seen this happen. I've never seen somebody type this in. Hey, you know what? Thanks for sharing your perspective. I'd never thought of it that way. I've changed my mind. I've never seen that happen. I said, I tell you what I see happen all the time, though. The sides become more and more polarized. Both sides start confirming their own biases, and we all have them. And then everybody's mad, and then they start attacking the person instead of dealing with the issue at hand. Recognize that no one knows everything, and the people who you disagree with know something you don't. And even if at the end of the conversation you still disagree, at least disagree with mutual respect. Point number four, be teachable. Be teachable. The antithesis of this is to be prideful. A prideful person is not teachable. A prideful person thinks they know everything. A prideful person thinks this: no one can correct my behavior because I'm in charge. There's a great scripture reference for this one. It says, let he who thinks he stand take heed lest he should fall. What does that mean? That means right about the time you think you've got it all together, you're going to fall. Here's a paradox for you. When I was talking to this person yesterday, I said, when I was running for office, people were mad because I was a pastor and I was running for office. And they would say things like, well, he shouldn't run for office. He's a pastor. He's a preacher. Okay. And then I get in office and then they say, he doesn't use enough scripture in his speeches. So like I say, no matter what, somebody's going to be mad at you. Be teachable. This creates an atmosphere. Be teachable. Who we surround ourselves with will impact who we become as leaders. Just about every day, and this is kind of my life now. It's like I'll come home, my son's like, so what'd you do today? I was like, I was in meetings. What else did you do? I was in meetings. It's like meeting after meeting after meeting. Without a doubt, though, every day when I'm in a meeting, I'm sitting and I'm listening to people who are subject matter experts in their area. And I'm listening, and more importantly, I'm hearing. And I think thirdly, which surprises a lot of them, I ask a lot of questions. I'm not embarrassed to ask questions. I ask questions because that's how I learn. If I don't know, I ask, right? And I ask a lot. And a lot of times I apologize for that, right? Because here's what happens inevitably. Human nature, oh my God, it's the chief. I'm rich, okay? It's rich. I'm a guy with 5 kids, 2 grandkids, a couple dogs. But inevitably, it's like, oh my gosh, it's the chief. He has all the answers. No, he doesn't. No, he doesn't. Just like none of you have all the answers either. None of us do, right? But what do? Automatically, we place somebody in leadership up on a pedestal. And certainly there are things that I know, okay? But there are things that you know as well. So when you're in an opportunity as a leader, question. Ask questions. Ask questions of all the people around you because they know lots of stuff that you don't know. We were in a school board meeting. It was a joint school board meeting with Swain County Schools and Cherokee Schools. And so they were talking about impact aid, and if you don't know what that is, you know, if you got non-Indian students going to a reservation school and vice versa, there's funding issues. So we worked out this MOA, MOU, so we can just transfer the funds. It's a pass-through. It works great. I didn't know that last week, but I went to this meeting. And so we're sitting in the meeting, and you know, the finance lady's up talking about all these things, and I'm looking around the room, because this is like the educator in me, right? So when you're looking around the room, you can tell when people are like, I'm not getting this. And at the end, does anybody have any questions? And everybody's looking around like, I got a question. So I just started asking questions. And at the end of it, I apologized, and I said, I'm sorry if I ask a lot of questions, but that's how I learned. I said, I know now, and now I can go explain if anybody, hey, Chief, what's impact aid? Well, have a seat. I'd be glad to explain it to you. Now I'm the subject matter expert, because I was in a room with a bunch of subject matter experts on impact aid. I can at least give you the aerial view of what it is. And if we have more questions, we'll go back to the experts. Never be afraid to ask questions. Be teachable. Number five, give everyone a voice. Google's Project Aristotle found this, that in addition to teams having clear goals and understanding projects with a larger context, it's mutual respect that's the key to success. Some of the best leaders on my team are the ones who give their employees, their managers, and their directors a voice in everything that happens. Several of them are in the room right now. And I love you guys. And I'm learning from you, from your leadership style, of how to do this. Give everyone a voice. Everyone has something to contribute. This creates an atmosphere of trust, which then allows individuals to grow and to flourish. The outcome is team and project success. When one succeeds, we all succeed. Empowering those in your charge will grow their confidence and improve creativity and performance. Number six, this is a big one. Avoid reactive and, in parentheses, programmed responses. All of us, if you have kids, you do this. If you're married, you do this. If you're not married and you don't have kids, consider staying single. But you'll have programmed responses to other relationships in your life. We just do. It's what we do, right? And so if there's something that happens in a relationship that kind of ruffles your feathers a little bit and you don't deal with it, every time it comes up, it'll be a bigger deal, even though it's not really a big deal. And then everything, every little thing becomes a big deal after that, right? So I was talking to somebody the other day who's a business owner, and they were talking about this relationship with one of their employees, and the employee was causing all this strife and everything else. And they said, oh my gosh, I got to the point where, like, I was driving to work, and I was just like, I was feeling sick. I was feeling nauseous driving to work. I'm like, yeah, I get that. But I said, you know, you have to deal with it. You have to deal with it. Confrontation, let me say this, confrontation isn't negative if it's done in a positive way. But none of us like confrontation. Like, we think, oh, I'll just say this and I'll say that. If you don't deal with it in a proactive manner, what will tend to happen is it explodes. So as a leader, we have to avoid these programmed just reactions, and we need to respond and not react. And there's a difference, because responding to something, and I used to, when I was a pastor, the advice that I used to give people on this one was like, I'd like, write it down. Have a script. You know, I would have parents, and then this was like really, this is probably 15 years ago when OxyContin was the big thing, you know. And yeah, I had a lot of parents who had adult kids who were living back at home because they'd lost their job, and they, you know. And so they're like, well, what do I do? You know, this is like, you know, months into it. Now they're kind of going crazy, because when you bring an addict to live with you, they bring all their baggage with them. And, you know, we've tried to help him, and, you know, he's just taking advantage of us, and he's stealing from us. What do we do? I was like, spell it out. Write it out. I said, right now, all you're doing is reacting. Every time something happens, you react. You yell, you scream, you threaten. If you do this again, this is what's going to happen. I said, write it down. Have a conversation when it doesn't matter. What I mean when it doesn't matter. You don't try to have the conversation in the midst of a heated explosion of, you know, over conflict. You sit down and you talk about it when it doesn't matter. And you go through it point by point by point. And whatever it is that you say at the bottom is going to be the consequences, you have to do it. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. But leadership's not easy. And leadership's not for cowards. And not everybody's ready for leadership. Number seven, the last principle. Be quick to admit when you're wrong. That's a good place for an amen. They're like, we're not in church. Be quick to admit when you're wrong, to yourself and to those around you. And again, on this one, there's no one walking this out perfectly. Understand this, every failure is an opportunity for growth, and that's how we have to see failure. I think one of the biggest things that frustrate me with public education, and as an educator, and this is being recorded, but I've said this to the entire staff at Cherokee Central Schools, elementary, middle, and high school, so it's okay to repeat it. We don't allow kids to fail these days. We don't. We're like, you know, and I used to say to the entire staff and the administration, I'd say, we have these young people in this controlled, safe environment. We have to teach them how to fail. Now, that seems counterintuitive, right? But guess what? Everybody sitting in this room has experienced failure in some way, shape, or form, right? Everybody. And yet, in the public education system, and certainly elementary, middle, and high school, we tend to try to soften the blow and not let kids experience the pain of failure, and then, more importantly, show them how to pick themselves up, learn from it, and go on. And then what do? Graduation day, oh, isn't it wonderful they graduated high school? I can assure you that the majority of high school kids leaving high school today are not prepared when failure comes. And so when it does hit, it's devastating because they've never experienced it in a controlled environment where somebody can talk them through it and say, listen, this isn't final. This is just the first in many failures that you're going to experience that you're going to have to learn from. That's life. Life is a series of learning from our experience. And again, as I said from the outset, the ones that hurt, I mean, those are the ones you never forget. I wish there was some other way. I really do. I think I said that in the last talk I was honored to give here, was, you know, I wish there was some other way for personal growth to come other than through suffering. But truth of the matter is that the life lessons that we remember most and the ones that we want to pass on to other people are usually the ones that were most painful to us. And you can tie that back together with the compassion piece, because once you've experienced that, it enables you to be compassionate with somebody else who's going through what you went through. And you can say, oh, listen, you're going to be okay. I've been through this myself. Come along, and you come alongside. Self-evaluate. Be honest with yourself and with others. Be prepared to take constructive criticism. Continually pursue self-enrichment through study and discourse. I want to close with this. Just a few quick points. As a cornerstone for leadership, I had a good friend of mine, Ty Boyd, did an interview with me yesterday on leadership for the Native Leadership Institute at Chapel Hill. And he wrapped up with this question. He was like, well, what would you say is, like, if you had to sum it up all in one word, what is leadership? And I was like, wow, man, nobody's ever asked me that before. And it just kind of hit me. It was like humility. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not walking around here like, I'm so humble. Oh, you're a humble servant. Not like that. I mean, like, humility being all of those things that I just described to you all flow out of a place of humility. Now, the paradox is this. Most people who are in leadership have a pretty high confidence level. Some would say they even have some ego. Okay, I'll give you that. There's a measure of ego that goes with it. Because think about it. Because you're in this situation, you go, I could be in charge. I could do that. But when you've been in leadership, you understand that being in charge means there's going to be a lot of things that come with that. It's not, I'm large and in charge. It's really like a place of humility where you're like, okay, everything I just said, those seven principles, all flow out of a place of humility. So it's really a foundation to the whole thing. And if there is any ego, if there is any pride, all of it is quickly undone by the daily distribution, small and large doses of humility that are often dealt to us as leaders. Right? You can be having a good day, and you're like, oh man, I just killed it in that one. And then you walk into the next meeting and you get killed. So, you know, it's even when you're on your A game, something will happen in the day that will remind you that you're not in charge of all this stuff. There will always be things that happen that are beyond your control. That being said, the seven principles which I just shared with you are only effective in the heart of a leader who can remain humble. And finally, sowing and reaping. I want to say this, you know, I started out by saying most of this I learned by doing it wrong. This is the truth right here. If you get nothing else out of this talk, get this. Everything that I've ever done wrong while under somebody else's authority has been done to me while in a position of authority, only worse. That's a hard truth, but it's the truth. everything that I have ever done wrong while under somebody else's authority has been done to me, only worse. Be that as a father, as a husband, as a business owner, educator, marine, etc. So I close with this. If you sow it, you'll reap it. So choose your seeds carefully and plant well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief Sneed. If we can have the panelists join us up front, that would be great. And all of those of you in the back, there are still some seats up here. If we can get y'all comfy and relaxed for this next part, I think we can squeeze you in. Couple over here in the front. So hello, welcome. We are now transitioning onto the panel part of our event today. My name is Dr. Callie Schultz. I'm an assistant professor of Parks and Recreation Management here at WCU, and I'm representing the PRM Student Club, who's one of the many sponsors making this amazing event possible. Now you may be thinking, what is the connection between Parks and Rec Management and Cherokee leadership? Well, Parks and Rec students focus a chunk of their studies on how to lead diverse groups of people in their leisure and recreation pursuits in order to live whole, happy, healthy human lives. Learning to lead from multiple perspectives and learning to see multiple worldviews is crux to being a successful leader to diverse populations. Thus, PRM students were especially keen to help bring the chief and the panelists to WCU to learn Cherokee perspectives on leadership. So to the WCU students today, thank you sincerely for being here. It is my challenge to you to consider how the lessons you learn here today apply to your field, whether closely related or not, and to your own personal leadership. I challenge you to pause when you have that things that make you go, or what? Or, wow, I never thought of this that way. And really ponder and sit with and engage with the new ideas surrounding leadership that are shared with you today. With that being said, it is my great honor to introduce our panel, who I know will provide us with fodder, inspiration, and new ideas surrounding leadership, particularly from various Cherokee perspectives. So y'all are familiar with Chief Sneed now. To Chief Sneed's right is Tanya Carroll. Tanya Carroll is the department manager of the Ray Kinsland Leadership Institute. She was born and raised in Cherokee, North Carolina. She studied American history and Cherokee studies at Western Carolina University, where she earned her master's degree in public history. In 2011, she graduated from the Right Path Adult Leadership Program, and in 2016, her passion for her community and Cherokee history and culture made becoming the department manager of the Ray Kinsland Leadership Institute a natural fit. There, she works with several leadership programs and specialists in order to create a generation of lifelong, selfless leaders deeply rooted in Cherokee history and culture. To Tanya's right is Shayna Lambert. Shayna Lambert is a member of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians and currently lives in Colowey, North Carolina. She attended UNC Chapel Hill for 2 years before transferring to Western Carolina University. She is a second semester junior in the nursing program and is working toward a Spanish minor. She is currently the president of the Degali'i, the Native American student organization at WCU, and she would like to serve the community at Anagalisi Hospital as a nurse once she graduates. To Shayna's right is Brittany Driver. Brittany Driver is a member of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians. She is from the Big Cove community in Cherokee, North Carolina. She graduated as valedictorian from Cherokee High School and is now a freshman studying psychology here at WCU. Brittany is also a student worker at the WCU Cherokee Center and a member of the Native Student Organization on campus. So here's how this is going to go. I have a couple questions for the panelists. I don't want you all to feel like you have to answer all the questions, although we would love to hear your input on all of them. Once we get rolling, it can be more of a conversation as well. So I'm going to start with question number one. Just a broad, please share with us your views on leadership from a Cherokee perspective.
I'll let you go first. I just did a whole talk. I'm texting down here.
Can everybody hear me?
Like,
Check, check.
Oh, yeah, they're wrong. You tapped it, it's good. I think it kind of goes along with what Richie said, and I kind of made a few notes, but I don't know where they went, so it'll be okay. I think it builds off of what Richie said earlier in his little talk about how he had, where he said that you have to put others before yourself, and you actually have to care about what you're doing. And you also have to listen, because if you care enough, then you listen and you get input from all of those around you, and you take those into consideration as well.
Okay, I think one thing I've noticed, like going off what Brittany was saying, how you have to listen to what other people are saying, a lot of the time people will throw out an idea, and even though it's not what you might end up going with, you still have to let them know that it was a valid idea and that you thought that it was great that they even spoke out, because a lot of people need that, like the motivation to keep talking. And so if they don't have that, then they won't contribute again. So I think a big thing is letting people know that you heard them and that what they're saying is necessary and that it's important to what your conversation is.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So just share some of your views on leadership from a Cherokee perspective.
So I think a lot of what I'm going to be talking about today really echoes what the other panelists and Chief Sneed has already said. But I think from a Cherokee perspective or an Indigenous perspective, that it's really important to have that sense of cultural identity and know who you are, know your history, where you come from, because in our culture, leadership skills are inherent. So if you're going by our traditional values and practicing those ideas, then you're going to be a good leader because the values that we're teaching enable you to do so. And in our programs that we have, we have the Cherokee Youth Council, the Jones Bowman Leadership Award Program, and the Duke Dunny Right Path Adult Leadership Program. And that's what we focus on ultimately with them is, you know, we have a really strong history as Cherokee people of resiliency. And once we learn that, you know, there's always going to be ups and downs and ebbs and flows in what's going on in our lives. But if we focus on our resilient history, we know that whatever comes our way, we're going to overcome. And we're going to overcome it because we're a strong community and because we help one another. And I think that is one thing that I would say is at the center of, you know, Indigenous leadership is, you know, like Chief Sneed said and the Native students here said, it's really important that people know that they matter and they know that you're respecting their opinions and what they're saying and that you believe in them and you encourage one another.
Chime in. So I was sitting here thinking about, you know, Jerry Wolf, you know, who was our beloved man who just passed away recently. He received an honorary doctorate from WCU. He really embodied everything Tanya's talking about. When I think about the Cherokee core values, Jerry lived that. It wasn't just words on paper for him. He was a living, you know, metaphor of that. He lived it every day, and he was full of grace and humility. He loved people. He loved all people. Full of wisdom and discernment, and just a good human being. And so, you know, when I think about from a cultural perspective, people like Jerry are few and far between. And I, you know, if Jerry was here, he'd probably say, and it took me 93 years to get there as well. So, he was a great man. Thank you.
Thank you all. So question two, we're wondering, Chief Sneed talked a lot about this in his talk, what leadership skills do you need to have as a Cherokee leader? Do you all have some additions to the ones that Chief Sneed presented?
Thick skin? I'm kidding, I joke.
Any thoughts on this?
Will you repeat it?
Oh, sure. What leadership skills do you need to have as a Cherokee leader?
I think you know, there's a lot of different kinds of leaders, and that's okay. So, you know, we have elected officials and people that can go out and, you know, really take the lead right off the bat. But then we have other people that I consider, they're in leadership roles because they see something that needs to be done and then they just do it. They don't ask anybody, they don't boast about it, they don't talk about it, they just go out and get the job done. And so we have a lot of different types of leaders in our communities, and I wanted to talk about one leadership skill, or, and I don't necessarily would call it a skill, but that Chief Sneed talked a lot about is, you know, being that type of servant leader and being selfless. And that is really important in our community, along with, you know, humility, because we have a lot of leaders, we call them quiet heroes, because they will go out and they will do what is necessary to help the community and better people's lives without wanting any kind of recognition at all. They just do it because it's the right thing to do and it's going to help people. And I think those ideas are very important, especially in our community and in Native communities. You know, around the world, you see the same types of skills and the same types of people that rise to leadership positions. They embody those ideas.
Does that help? Yeah. To add on to what Tanya was saying, I think where she was talking more about how you need to be selfless and serve other people, I think it's also important to remember, I don't mean to say this in a bad way, that other people can serve you. And I just mean that to say, like, you can rely on other people. And it's okay to do that. Because a lot of the time, at least in my leadership position, where I'm in charge of something smaller, which is our campus group, I rely on Brittany for a lot of stuff. And she's not even one of our elected officers, but I rely on her for so many things. And that can even just be emotional support. It doesn't just have to be me telling her or asking her, can you go do this for me? So yeah, I would say definitely relying on people and like having that trust in them is important.
Do you want to add something, Brittany?
I would probably have to say honesty, because if you're honest, then you know that people are going to trust you. Because if you can be honest with people, then people are going to most likely trust you. And that, I think, more qualifies you to be a good leader.
Thank you so much. So the third question sort of spins off of what Chief Sneed talked about in his talk as well, and the conversation that we had directly following this event. That things are rather polarized in today's society. So we really want to know, what challenges do you face to Brittany and Shayna, specifically on campus? What challenges as a leader on campus are you facing, and how are you dealing with those challenges? And then for Tanya and Chief Sneed, within your profession, what challenges are you facing and how are you dealing with those?
For on campus, I think it's more, since we are a Native student organization and we are small and just, you know, restarting it up and everything. I think it's just the fact of letting people know that, you know, we're here and that we're doing stuff. But I think the more we get involved with stuff, it's kind of helping.
I would definitely say that visibility, like she was saying, is an issue for us, especially because a lot of the other campus leaders that I see, I mean, they're all really nice people, but they also are very direct, and that's not my way of doing things, at least. I like to sit back and let people say what they want to say, and then I'll chime in. So, and I realize that's how a lot of people are in our student group as well. So I really think that that's been an issue for us, where people throw out what they want to do and maybe take up a space on campus and do something, and we're thinking, well, maybe somebody else already took that or something like that. So I think on campus that's been our main issue, is not really pushing for things. We want to be out there and we want people to know who we are, but at the same time we don't want to take anybody else's space from them. So that's where we're at.
Come together. So In the position I'm in now, there's a whole set of challenges. I mean, so politically, you know, the biggest challenge, I guess, is that, and it's kind of a paradox, is that the same people who I am responsible for in the day-to-day operations of the tribal organization, which is close to 1,200 employees, the majority of them are voters as well, right? That's a challenge. Well, what challenge does that pose? So I have to act with integrity in my heart to say, well, I'm not going to do something special for Tanya because, well, she can vote for me. I have to apply policy and the law equally and fairly to everybody, right? At the same time, and we had this discussion yesterday about compassionate leadership, the other challenge is that all of these same folks who are employees and who are voting members of our community are members of our community, and they're all family. We're all related. So every decision that's made, if I make a decision that impacts Tanya, well, she could be married to somebody who's this person. Everybody's related. It's a challenge, right? So when a decision's made, trying to get the public to understand that this is what the policy was, this is what the law was, and that's why we did it this way, knowing full well, again, somebody's going to be mad about it, and yet it has to be done that way. It came out in a business committee meeting I was in, and one of the council members said, well, I just think everybody should be treated fairly. And I said, I couldn't agree with you more. And here's how we ensure everybody's treated fairly. We apply the law or we apply the policy equally and equitably to everybody. That's fair. Here's the rub. And this is totally different from what they're dealing with because it's politics, and so it's different, right? So when you're running for office, people say, I just want to be treated fairly. I want everybody to be treated the same, until it comes down on them and it's time for it to be dealt equitably to them. Whoa, wait a second. The politicians in the front row are like, yes, that's right. So that's a challenge, okay? So the reason it's a challenge is because as a leader, and again, this is the thing, you know, like my I don't know what you call it, my tagline when I was running for vice chief was this: leadership, not politics. I'm not gonna play politics. And I said, if that means I only stay for one term, then that means I only stay for one term. Because I will tell you this, the truth of the matter is that for all the talk about people say, we want change, people like things the way they are. It's human nature, right? We get comfortable in what we're doing. We get comfortable. My wife put it this way, and we're so different. That's why I like what I do, because it's something different every 5 minutes. And she told me, she said, if every day were exactly the same, I would love that. And I'm like, I would hate that. But the reality is for a lot of us, we like our routine. We like things the way that they are. But the reality is that the way things are politically in this nation, at the state level, and even at the tribal level, it's what Milton Friedman called the tyranny of the status quo, right? It is how it is. Everybody knows it's not right and it needs to change, but nobody wants to make the hard decisions to make it change because it impacts people. But if we don't change it, guess what? It impacts people. Now that's a challenge. So if anybody has the answer, come see me afterwards and we'll write a book together.
Sometimes I think when we hear, you know, the word challenge or what kind of challenges are you facing, it has a negative connotation to it. And in our line of work with the leadership programs, one of the biggest challenges that we face is that people now have so many opportunities. And our challenges is having to compete with those opportunities to get time. So with our youth council, our Jonesboro, and even the adults, you know, we're competing with other programs, with school, with full-time jobs, families, you know, their home life, and you know, that we're not making any more time. And so we have to figure out innovative ways to keep people's interest and to get them involved in our programs and to stay in our programs. And that becomes more difficult because there's so many great opportunities out there and people are just getting stretched too thin. That's one of the challenges. And going along with that, just being able to come up with a good balance between that, because a lot of the people that we rely on to help teach leadership skills and cultural values and history and culture in our programs, they're always the ones that people go to because you can rely on them and they're responsible. And so we don't want to burn them out either by calling on them too much and taken too much of their time. And so those are probably the two biggest challenges we face. Is even as a staff, we're a really small staff, and we're tasked with doing, you know, some pretty major things in the community. And so we have to take the time to take care of ourselves and our home life and personal lives also. And those become big challenges for us, because we still want to go out and give our time and help our community, but we have to take care of ourselves first in order to do that and do a good job at it.
Thank you. So now what I want to do is offer an opportunity for those of you in the audience to ask any pressing questions that you have of any of the panelists of Chief Sneed. Yes.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, everybody. Everybody for coming. It's so nice to be here. What can a citizen of this area do in a leadership role to support the Cherokee Nation and the tribe?
I think that there's been strained relationships in the past, and one of the things that my administration is working hard to do is to rebuild those bridges and rebuild those relationships with the surrounding counties and county leaders, county commissioners. The tribe was just brought into the Southwestern Commission, the Council of Governments. To answer your question, it's more of what one of the young ladies on the end said, was to listen, you know, to really hear our perspective on things. I think that for a lot of years, the Cherokee perspective, the Cherokee voice was kind of silenced in the region. You know, we were kind of delegated to our little corner of Western North Carolina. We felt like what we had to say didn't matter. There certainly is a long history, or has been a history of oppression, and which, let me say this, I'm not suggesting for a second that exists now, but it certainly has existed. There has certainly been wrongs that were committed in the past. And, when I was in my 20s, a good friend of mine, Patty Grant, who, if you know Patty Grant, she's awesome, and she just lights the room up with her smile. And I was in my 20s, and I'm 50 now. I hate saying that. But anyway, she said to me, she was talking to me about historical trauma. And in my 20s, like, nah, Patty, I don't know if I really buy into that. But years of working as a pastor and certainly being in leadership, you can see kind of a cycle of when there has been trauma imposed upon a people, how that is passed down from generation to generation. In the same way that all the positives can be passed down, the negatives can as well. So I think that just understanding that and having a good listening ear, and I guess to kind of put a bow on it, for decades we were told, this is what you need to do, this is, you need to learn from us, because, you know, and it goes all the way back to Christian missionaries who said, in order for you people to know God, you need to come live like us. Well, we knew God already. We were doing just fine before the missionaries got here, you know. So, and I'm not trying to be harsh. I'm just saying you have to understand that colonization and the influx of Europeans. And I was talking to the chancellor, you know, over lunch about this. If you go back and read the Cherokee v. Georgia Supreme Court case from 1830, and read the opinion of the court and what they said about Cherokee people, they said, well, they're to be viewed as little children who need a father to protect them and to meet their needs. And I thought, the arrogance. We were here for thousands of years before you got here. Not you, him, you know, and I'm just like, but the arrogance. But I said, you know, in our discussion, I was saying, but you have to understand that way of thinking permeated the country at that time, that indigenous people were somehow inferior. Andrew Jackson said, and I'll get the quote wrong, but he said, they, speaking of the Cherokee, are going to have to come to terms with the fact that they are faced with a superior race, and they'll need to come to grips with their inferiority. So understanding that, having an understanding that was imposed upon our ancestors, and a little bit of that gets passed on from generation to generation. But to Tanya's point, we're resilient. You know, we're a resilient people, and we're here. And just, I guess, just being respectful of that we are a sovereign people, you know. And again, not trying to be harsh. I'm not trying to be harsh at all. But we're strong, you know. And we're here to partner with our neighbors in the region And that's probably a really long answer to it. I don't want to be offensive. But at the same time, I'm trying to communicate to our people that we are strong and we are powerful and we are resilient. And that's not an egotistical, arrogant thing to say. That is a truth. So.
I'm of the Jewish tribe, so I know all about inherited trauma. And I did name my dog Tohi, which is a Cherokee name, to just try to honor you and the tribe in any way I can.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I'm wondering, as a stakeholder in an organization, a school, community, whether you be a student or an employee or a citizen, how do you give feedback to a leader that isn't necessarily a servant leader? In an organization that's being run from the top down with a policy or decision that you disagree with, how would you present to that, whether it be the president of a school or a principal of a school or a politician?
Anybody? I can answer that. You want anyone to take a shot at that?
Okay.
Short answer is if we're talking about somebody who's dictatorial, you probably won't be heard anyway. Just being realistic. Certainly I have in times past, be it in the church environment, being part of different ministries, I have worked under people who were dictatorial, and they're probably not going to hear you. That being said, there is the methodology. People like that are usually very legalistic. So everything has to be done to the letter and in accordance with the proper policy and procedure and protocol. And I don't want to discourage you from doing that, but I think you need to be prepared for the fact that they're probably not going to listen to you. If that is their leadership style, they probably won't listen to you. So, but if you do decide to go that route, do it with lots of respect and do follow every protocol and process. Did you want to say?
That's what I was going to say. Do it with respect.
Okay. You That's why she's in charge of the Leadership Institute.
Another question?
Go for it. I know you spoke a little bit about when the Europeans came over and kind of changed everything for your culture. And so I was wondering, I know the leadership style was different before the Europeans came over and kind of took that over. So I was wondering if you have seen a shift towards the older leadership styles that your tribe might have had before.
I'm trying to figure out where to start with my answer, but since our history spans so far into the past that, there's different ways that we handled leadership historically, traditionally, and we still have aspects of that we use in our community. And we've also brought in, some westernized styles of leadership and ways to kind of govern ourselves. But I think ultimately we are seeing more people in our community becoming interested in learning more about our history and culture, even predating contact. And the way that we try to foster that in our programs is to bring in people in the community that have grown up in more of a traditional lifestyle. And so some things that we teach in the programs about leadership that have been passed on is, how to identify the people that you want to be leaders. Traditionally, it could be they would identify a leader by at a very young age and just notice, there's always people that you see out that people just want to follow. They have some kind of energy. And a lot of the times it's kind of the person that's mischievous or is getting into some trouble. People tend to just gravitate towards them and follow them. So at a young age, they would identify these people that were like that and bring them in and foster them and teach them the skills that they needed. And so they become a more productive member of the society. And so really we focus on that as a lifelong learning process. And I think everybody kind of touched on this is that, it's just not like one day you're a leader. you know, like it's a whole process and you're always learning and it goes on throughout your life. But in my lifetime, I've seen more people become interested in learning those types of things about our history and culture than I know like my mom's age group probably grew up with. And a lot of it has to do with our young people just saying, we want to know, like it's our right to know this stuff too. We want to know this. And then the older people with the knowledge, you know, being willing to share that also. I hope that, I don't know if that answered the question.
If I can add
kind
just,
of got off on a tangent.
That's all right. Just add just a little bit to it. You know, we've, certainly our government model, we've adopted a lot of, you know, the Western form of government, representative democracy, if you will, which has its own set of challenges, but at the same time, it's kind of a hybrid model in that we take two representatives from each community, which kind of still goes with the old way. So there's a hybrid facet to it, but the majority of it is really an adaptation of, you know, like the way the federal government operates. But to Tanya's point as well, we are sovereign, and one of the things that we as a tribe, Eastern Band really is a leader in Indian country as far as how we exercise sovereignty as a tribal government. You know, the two gentlemen sitting in front of you are county commissioners, and we talk, and they're like, yeah, we can only do what the state tells us we can do, right? So they make decisions in accordance to with what Raleigh says. Okay, guys, you can make a decision about this. What's Jackson County going to do on this particular issue? Whereas the tribe, we have the sovereignty to make decisions a lot like the federal government does for our people in our community. That's pretty powerful, you know, when you think about it. Like, sometimes I sit around and think about that, I'm like, man, that's really cool, you know. So I mean, you know, I'm not trying to be nerdy about it, but it's pretty amazing when you think about it that we, as a tribal government, and our people, and they have a voice in it, and they exercise their voice in it, you know, and that's a good thing, even though sometimes that you know, we disagree or I may disagree with how people tend to voice their, you know, because I'm always about be respectful. You can voice it without yelling and screaming, but that's another talk. But just the fact that we have that ability to do that, and we make decisions for ourselves in accordance with our culture and our value system, is we still do that. So that part's great.
One thing that I want to add to your question, where you were asking, like going back to seeing old ways and incorporating them into the new ways, I definitely see that in people around my age group. Like kids in their 20s and then kids even younger than me who are really interested in the old ways and kids that really want to bring those things back and revitalize them. And we see that a lot with our language. That's one of the big things that I think a lot of the different age groups are focused on. But you'll see it also in things like our arts, where a lot of kids want to know how to like weave baskets these days and do traditional arts. And then also the way that you're supposed to treat people. Like, so intangible concepts. So I think a lot of people in my age group want to see those things actually be like shown. They don't want to just talk about it and have it just be written down and this is how it's supposed to be. They want to embody it. So I can't really give you like a concrete example, but I just know that I see that a lot with my friends and people that are friends of my friends who will talk about what they're doing and how they want to change things.
Can add to that real quick on just on the point that she was making there was Juanita texted me Gadoogie, right? And it's doing things the right way, you know, doing things the right way. There's a right way, it's the right path, there's a way to do it. Tanya had it in her notes. So anyway.
So I'm going to point out the obvious, not that Chief Sneed, you've mentioned your age already before, but there are three females sitting on this panel who are young females coming up in leadership roles, and I'm wanting to hear from them, is there a difference in being female and being in leadership versus being male? And have you experienced that difference, sensed that difference? Because we know that if it's in the political realm, we know that women are treated differently.
Go first.
I was going to say, well, I'll
throw some history down.
Okay.
I don't want you to go first to that.
Okay. there you go.
So I definitely think there is a difference in the way that you would see a woman leader and a man leader, or female and a male leader. I guess that's a better way of saying it. Definitely in our community, there's so many women that we can look up to because we do have our traditional roles of leadership, like the beloved woman, and we have multiple beloved women. And so the way that I see them leading is that quiet leadership where they don't say so much or publicly, but where they're doing things behind the scenes. And so I think the way that they're supposed to be treated, like traditionally, is that with total respect, and their word is final, and that's the way that it is. And I think that some people respect that and other people don't. But at the end of the day, for me at least, I like to take their lessons and apply them to my life. So even if I might not be the greatest leader, like as I grow up, I'll become better and better, and then I'll be able to follow their example in that way. And so I want to be more of a quiet leader. I never want to be the person who's up here talking, even though I'm talking right now. But I don't know. I definitely think, like, even though the way that we view female and male leadership in our community is different, I think both of them are valuable for what they are.
Could you just clarify beloved women, what that looks like, who they are, what the political structure is for us who don't know?
Traditionally, a beloved woman was not like a member of the official council, I guess you would say, but she would be like elected as under the people. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So she's more like today, more of a community leader. She's not like, you wouldn't think of her as a council member, like it's its own thing. And she is usually a lot older. She has a lot of wisdom, like from living her whole life. I don't know how to put this. You explain it better.
So traditionally the title of beloved woman would be applied in different townships. So we had autonomous villages, and there would be beloved women selected by the people in that village, and her ultimate role was to keep the village safe. She, like the other leaders in the community, had counselors, had other women from that, and they're all older women, you know, wiser, that have experience. I guess probably a little bit more calmer too, that, you know, try to see all sides of everything. But they would meet, and ultimately there were decisions put on them that when they made it, it was final. And so whether or not a village would go to war, whether or not maybe people captured in times of war were how they were treated after, you know, the battle or the fighting was over, that's the type of role they held. So it was a highly esteemed position in the different villages. And today, since we're all kind of one larger community, the title, you know, holds esteem for women that still lead in those same ways. They have cultural knowledge. They've helped out in the communities. They're kind of known as everybody's grandmother. They've helped raise, you know, people, taught them the values, taught them, you know, to respect women and what that means and what that looks like in our culture. So that's kind of what, you know, the title is and how it's held then and today. And speaking to, you know, the differences in leadership in our culture, it's okay that men and women have separate roles. That, you know, was part of our traditional customs. There, you know, there's sometimes where only women can do something and only men can do something, and that's okay. But it's important that we put the same value on those roles and what they're doing, and that's equal. And in historically and traditionally, women were even held to a higher esteem because they're life givers and because they're able to bring a different perspective to conversations and to decision making. And so I think that's important to highlight, because, you know, we're equal, but it's okay that we can have these different roles and do these different things. I work mostly I'm not an elected official, and so I can't really speak to that side of kind of having leadership roles, but I haven't felt like I've had that many issues in the community being a woman. But I work with people that honor those things and honor those traditions. And like Shana was saying, we're still individual people. And so there's some people that honor those, and there's some people that didn't grow up in that lifestyle, and they may have a different perspective on things. You know, and that's okay too. Ultimately, we just want to respect everyone and have that respect for everyone, no matter what. And that goes not just gender, but age. So, you know, we have a respect for the youth voice and their opinion because they bring a different perspective. And we have a respect for the elderly people because they have a different perspective. But all that kind of comes together when you're making a decision, and it's important to hear all the different sides. And I think that's ultimately, you know, kind of what I want to get out there is that, you know, everybody's voice is important, and it helps to hear those perspectives in order to make the best decision that's going to help everybody.
I want to say I didn't want to answer first. I just want to throw some history down. So when Europeans first made contact, they couldn't fathom the fact that Cherokees included their women in decision making, in decisions about what the tribe was going to do, political decisions. Women have always had an equal voice in Cherokee culture. That was really difficult for Europeans to wrap their head around, and it probably still is difficult for some people to wrap their head around today. But clearly, and I guess probably one of the things that for me, you know, as an educator, and certainly being in industrial arts, my classes were typically more male students. You know, it was usually like 90% male, 10% female. I think that, you know, with the way that plays out now is oftentimes that, you know, the with our younger men, it's they don't necessarily see themselves in that, like, I have to be, you know, in charge or anything like that. It's just completely accepted in our culture that women are leaders within our culture, and it's always been that way. And I appreciate the, you know, the comments about the beloved women, is that they are and were and always have been those quiet leaders, full of wisdom, full of grace, highly respected in the community. And when they give the word, that's it. I mean, that's law. So that's good.
I would say that it kind of does echo what all they just said, you know, especially about the women and the men having different roles. I see it both as equally important, I guess, you know, because, I mean, women do play an important role in our society, but men do too, and it's just like two different styles of leadership, I guess, if that's the right way to put it. Yeah.
Thank you. Another question?
So, as a group of people who aren't members of the culture and the community, how can we kind of support and embrace and become allies without unknowingly overstepping boundaries or unknowingly acting like our voice is more important, even though it's not, and just kind of, I don't know, help you guys get to the point, I guess, that you want to get to in society and in the community.
I just want to say, like, on a personal level, like, just with your friends, not even thinking, like, on a large scale, just, like, making sure that they feel comfortable to share what they want about their culture with you. And I guess that just is, like, interpersonal skills. Because definitely with my friends who aren't Cherokee, as long as they're making me feel like what I'm saying is important to them and that they're interested in it, then they don't overstep. Because if they say, oh, I don't want to be, you know, offensive or disrespectful, but you can just ask and we'll tell you, like, whatever you want to know or whatever we can tell you. And so, yeah, I definitely think just in terms of, like, being an ally is to be friendly. I can't speak to, like, say, for example, supporting businesses or support, the government or things like that, because that's not my area of expertise right now. But definitely on like the small scale, making sure that people know that like you want to be respectful, but you still want to know things. So yeah.
I can answer from a political perspective. So from a political perspective, we certainly need support on issues of, and not just us. I mean, there are Indian tribes. I was just at a congressional caucus meeting out in California. I was really taken aback at the level of poverty that exists on a lot of the reservations out west. For example, the one of the Apache reservations, the unemployment rate's 85%. You have tribes in Arizona and New Mexico who have no right to the water that's on their land. So here it is, 2018, and they're still driving in a pickup truck with plastic barrels on the back of their truck to go to a local watering hole to get water to take back to their home with no indoor plumbing. So on issues like that, those are things that need to be brought to the forefront of the thinking of the rest of the nation. As the Eastern Band, I mean, we are, I was sitting at this meeting just sitting there thinking how blessed we are as a people. And again, you know, Cherokee as really leaders in Indian country. Locally, on issues for us, land issues, land into trust, those rules are changing now where the federal government is looking more to the counties and saying, well, county leaders, do you want the Cherokee to have this land into trust? Because you know it's going to affect your tax base. If we take 100 acres of land in Jackson County into trust that, no offense, was ours to begin with, and we take it back into trust, that's money that the county doesn't get in tax valuation anymore. So when those things happen, we certainly need political support there. Those are phone calls, letters, emails, tweets to elected officials. But those are hard things sometimes because, again, that affects the people in the county as well, but we certainly need support there as well.
Oh, did you want to go?
No.
Okay. Yeah, it does kind of go off of what Shana said. It does have a lot to do with, you know, asking questions, but it's also listening and understanding, especially that we are different, I guess, you know, because we look at things differently, because we are technically, I mean, we are a different culture, and, I mean, I think it changes the way we view things. So when we do say, like, something that matters to us, and then someone's like, oh, no, it's okay, whatever, don't listen, then it's just kind of like trying, I would kind of view it as silencing, you know, because it kind of just makes you want to back off.
And to add to that, maybe if you have people from Eastern Band that are sharing things with you or talking to you about issues, to try not to diminish their perspective or what they're saying by saying things like, well, that happened a really long time ago, and, you know, and just saying things like that, because our people do a really good job at appearing to blend in or, you know, being like everybody else, and but in reality, you know, they're having to live in two really different worlds. And sometimes I don't even think we're conscious of it. But there are differences, and sometimes they're just subtle differences in the way that they were brought up and in their culture and in their beliefs that a lot of the times can diminish their voice. And so being more encouraging and being more thoughtful about your comments could really help them open up and tell you more, or, you know, tell you different things that you could learn from.
Thank you. I think we have one more question to wrap up with. I'll ask it. So I want to know, where are we in 5 years with the Western Cherokee partnership relationship, students? Where's your vision of where we can be in 5 years? Dreams, hopes, students, you may or may not be here still.
I would like to see more Native students on campus and more active in what we're doing.
Okay, yeah, definitely being more active, because I think we have okay numbers right now who are from the Eastern Band of kids who go to school here, but not so many that are really active. So that's definitely something that both me and Brittany have talked about a lot, is trying to get kids to be more involved in our club. And it doesn't even just have to be in our club. It can be in whatever respective club they want to be in, but still taking on leadership roles where they can bring their unique perspective to that.
So I really like to dream and think and plan and do things like that. So just off the top of my head, I would in 5 years from now, I would hope that every single person that sets foot on this campus would be educated on the history of this land and the importance of it, and know the Gadua story behind it, and be educated on, you know, that there was a Cherokee village here and the importance of that, and how I think there's maybe even a lot of students that go here that don't even realize that the Eastern Band's there and is so close. And I think just the level of education about who we are, where this place, you know, the origins of this place, is that every single person would know about it once they set foot on the campus would be, I think, a realistic 5-year goal. So we can work on that.
To just kind of springboard off what Tanya said there, to see what has been initiated this year with Cherokee as the theme, and the emphasis that has been placed on the culture that resided on this land, to see that continue this year really was, we've had a great working relationship with Western for many years. My hope is that we would continue to see that grow, but I couldn't sum it up any better, Tanya. I mean, you nailed it. That was great. And this year, really, the theme of this year, to me, is really the leaping off point. And the statue that's going to go in the courtyard out there, just amazing. And, of course, a starting lineup for the offensive line and a quarterback for the team, all from Cherokee, would be a good place to start as well.
So. Thank you all so very much for being here today. We see this just as the beginning of a conversation, and we actually still have about 30 minutes. We have refreshments kind of behind the screens back there. And so we really welcome and invite you all to stay and talk with one another and talk with our panelists and share ideas and conversation. Thank you for coming. Sometimes I wake up.